Okay, so today we are going to look at some previous year questions asked in UGC and NET from Microprocessor 8085 and 8086. So we have picked questions from 2017, 16, 15, 14. You can just have a look and have an idea that how, what type of questions they are asking. So firstly, we're looking at questions from UGC NET 2017. See, just look at the question. In 8085 microprocessor, which of the following flag is R affected by an arithmetic operation? So basically we are having five flags which are placed like this. S, which is sign flag, Z, X, X is don't care, AC, X, P, X, CY. So this is how the five flags are placed. This is the sign flag. This is a zero flag. This is auxiliary carry. So already in the lectures we've explained, we have had a lecture on flags, but still you can again see auxiliary carry is the carry which occurs from lower 4 bits to higher 4 bits, and if there is a carry from lower 4 bits to higher 4 bits, this auxiliary carry flag is going to be 1 if auxiliary carry occurs, right? Otherwise it's going to be 0. The 0 flag is going to be 1 if result is 0, if accumulator holds 0 after some arithmetic operation. If the result is 0, the 0 flag is going to be 1, and the sign flag is going to be the MSB of the result. This holds the value of MSB of the result, right? And then this P is the parity flag. This is parity flag. So parity flag is, see, there's a concept of parity which indicates number of ones in the result. If number of ones is even, if there is even number of ones, then this parity flag is going to be one. If even number of one in result, and this is going to be zero if odd number of ones in result. Fine. And then this last one is carry flag. So we know carry flag, if a carry or borrow occurs in an arithmetic operation, this carry flag is going to be 1 if carry or borrow occurs, if carry or borrow occurs in an arithmetic operation, this is going to be 1. So what happens is, whenever you're performing an arithmetic operation, all these flags are going to be affected, right? So in any arithmetic operation, S, Z, A, C, P, Y, all these flags are going to be affected. So the answer is going to be option 4. This is going to be the correct answer, because all these flags are going to be affected. See, there are some instructions, some logical instructions, AND or XOR, where carry and auxiliary carry are not affected. Carry and auxiliary carry are not affected in logical instructions like AND or XOR, etc. Okay, but in arithmetic operations, all of these flags are going to be affected. Then there are several instructions like INR, which increases the contents of a register, INR C, INR B. In that also, carry flag is not affected. But in case of arithmetic operation, as in this question, all these flags are going to be affected. Okay, let us look at the next question now. In 8085, the address bus is of dash bits. See, we know that every memory location in 8085 memory location is having 16 bit long address. Since every memory location is having 16 bit long address, we have to have an address bus of 16 bits, right? We need a 16 bit address bus so that we can just give the memory location and reach there. So what happens in 8085 is, out of 16 bits of address bus, the 16 bits of the address bus that you are having, 8 bits are solely means completely for the address only, solely for address bus, and the other 8 bits are there 8 bits or 8 lines. 8 bits are multiplexed with the data bus, which means that 8 lines of the address bus are multiplexed with the data bus. They are going to be used as address bus or data bus according to the status of ALE, address latch enable. We've discussed all this in the lecture although, so you can just see here there. So address bus is going to be 16 bits long, right? Look at the next question. In the architecture of 8085, match the following. Okay, we're going to look at them one by one. Processing unit means that where all the operations are going to be loaded. When we looked at designing of 8085, the basic idea of 8085, we saw that we designed 8085 for performing some basic arithmetic operation, logical operations, so that operations like addition, subtraction could be done by using a single unit. So processing unit or you can say brain of 8085 is going to be ALU. Arithmetic logical unit. This is where all the operations are going to be performed, right? This is where you're going to do all the major work, right? Then instruction unit is going to be timing and control. See, instruction unit means that where you're giving the instruction, who will tell about the instruction. So instruction unit is going to be timing and control. Then storage and interface unit is general purpose register. So according to this, the answer is going to be second option, option B. Okay, you can just see, right? Look at the next question. Which of the following address mode is best suited to access elements of an array of continuous memory location? Okay, maybe this is some misprint. Misprint is there. This is continuous. Okay, continuous, right? So see, we've learned about addressing modes, right? So we saw there that what happens in indexed addressing mode is, indexed addressing mode, you're just increasing the index, you're just giving some additional bits to the base address, and the address location keeps on increasing, and you can just access memory locations which are placed continuous to each other. So when you have to access elements of an array, then you can use indexed addressing mode. This is the best suited addressing mode for this. Okay. So now here it is asking which of the following is correct statement. We're going to look at all the statements one by one, and we can also see that what correction is needed. Okay. So just look at the first statement. In memory mapped IO, memory mapped IO is in which you are giving IO locations as memory addresses only. Addressable memory size decreases and IO devices are treated as memory locations only. We can use instructions like LDA, STA, right? So it is saying that in memory mapped IO, the CPU can manipulate IO data residing in interface registers that are not used to manipulate memory words. So this is a wrong statement, right? CPU can manipulate IO data residing in interface registers. This is wrong statement, because what happened in memory mapped IO is CPU is treating IO devices as memory locations only, right? And here it's writing it's not used to manipulate. So this is a wrong statement. We are treating IO devices as memory locations only. Addressable memory size decreases, and if we want to access IO data, so we are using them as memory words. Right. Now look at the second statement. Isolated IO means IO mapped IO. Isolated IO method isolates memory and IO addresses so that memory address change is not affected by interface address assignment. So this is correct statement. What happens in IO mapped IO? Memory size is not affected because the IO devices are not treated as memory locations. We are having separately 8-bit addresses for IO. So it isolates memory and IO so that memory range is not affected. So this is the correct statement. This is going to be the answer. Still, let us look at third statement. In asynchronous serial transfer of data, two units share a common clock. Okay, so asynchronous, we know asynchronous means that they are not sync. They are not having a common clock. Okay, so they do not share a common clock. Okay, so this is wrong. Last statement says in synchronous serial transmission of data, two units have different clocks. So they do not have different clocks. Synchronous means they are having same clock. Their clocks are synced. Right, okay, so the answer is going to be second one. Okay, now look at this question. So see, we've already seen that there is a register in 8086 which is AX, and it's having two registers AH and AL, where this is a 8-bit register, this is also a 8-bit register, and this AX is going to be a 16-bit register. Okay, it's having two sub registers AH and AL. Fine, so now what happens is, now just look at the instructions one by one. What we are doing is, we're loading AL with 15, which means AL becomes 0F in hexadecimal, right? 0F. Then AH becomes 0F. Now what happens after these two instructions, if we look at AX is going to be 0F0F. Right? So now, when we are doing XOR AL, if you XOR contents of a register with itself, then the contents are going to become 0, 0, right? Because you know 1 XOR 1 and 0 XOR 0, both are 0. So AL is going to become 0, 0, which is why AX is going to be 0F00. Now what you're doing is we've loaded CL with 3. CL is another register, right? We loaded CL with 3. Now what does this instruction do? This is shift right AX comma CL, which means we have to shift right the contents of AX according to the value of CL is 3. So we're going to make 3 right shifts to the contents of AX. Now already AX was holding these were the contents of AX. Now if you right shift it three times, if you're going to right shift it, what happens is, okay, so this is 01E0. So these are the contents of AX after 3 right shifts. Okay, now what we are doing is we are adding AL we are adding 90 in hexadecimal. So this is the contents of AL right now. If you're going to add 90, this AX is going to become 0, 1, 0. If you just perform this addition, you'll get 7. Okay, you can just see, you'll get 7. This is going to be the, and carry flag is going to be 1 because a carry is going to occur in this addition. Okay. Carry is going to occur in this operation. So carry flag is going to be 1. So these are the contents of this AX right now. Okay, AX is going to be 0, 1, 7, 0. Carry flag is going to be 1. Now the last operation is add with carry AH comma 0, which means that to the contents of AH, we have to add 0 along with the carry. So you add 0 along with the carry. Carry flag was 1. So you just perform this operation. Final value of AX is going to be 0 to 70, which is first option. Okay, so this is how you're going to perform this operation. You're going to perform this program, right? Okay. Look at the next question. So what is it saying is, the contents of register BL and AL are 49H and 3AH. Contents of AL, status of carry flag and sign flag after executing, subtract AL comma BL. Okay, fine. See, what this operation is going to do is subtract AL comma BL. What is it going to do is, contents of AL are 3A, which is 0011, 1010. Contents of BL49, which is 0100, 1001, just going to subtract them. So I'm taking a borrow here, borrow this one which presents 2, right? In binary this is a borrow of 2. So 2 minus 1 is going to be 1. This becomes 0 after that. So 0, 0, 0, 1, 1. Now see, since there is no 1 here, I'm going to need a borrow. Going to need a borrow. Right? So carry flag is going to be set. See, this carry flag also represents borrow for arithmetic operations. So this, since I have taken this borrow, this carry flag is going to be 1. Now see, 1, this is going to be 1, this represents 2, right? Yeah. And fine, this is also going to be 1. I have taken a borrow here, right? From here I have taken this borrow, so it's going to be 1. So the contents of AL, see what is this operation doing is, what this operation does is, is going to subtract the contents of BL from register AL and store the final value in AL, store the final result in AL. So the contents of AL are going to be F1, carry flag is going to be 1 because we had a borrow, and sign flag is the MSB of the result, MSB of the one result, which is 1. So the correct option is going to be third one. This is going to be the correct option. Okay, look at the next question now. Okay, so we are given with 4 different addressing modes, and you need to just tell that where is the location of operand in the specified addressing mode. So just look at them one by one. Implied addressing mode is specified implicitly in the definition of instruction. See, we've looked at several instructions of implied addressing mode, which was STC, CMA, CMC, yeah, right, STC, CMC, CMA, set carry, complement carry, complement accumulator. So what happens is that whatever has to be done is specified implicitly in the definition of instruction. No operand is present in the implied addressing mode. We are just performing some operations with flags or accumulator. So, right? So this implied addressing mode is going to be matched with the fourth option, specified implicitly in the definition of instruction. Now immediate addressing mode. Immediate, what happens in immediate addressing mode is location of operand is, operand is going to be specified in the register. What happens in immediate addressing mode is that in the instruction only, wherever the opcode is stored, next memory location is going to be the data, right? So this is going to be specified in the registers. We are going to match this with third. In register addressing mode, see, we are not accessing memory in register addressing modes, right? All the operands, all the data lies in the CPU itself. So in register addressing mode, operand is going to be in the registers which are in CPU. So I'm going to match this with first. And register indirect, what happens in register indirect? Register specify the address of the operand, like move A comma M. So what you're going to do is you're going to reach the HL pair, just see what is stored in that. That is going to be treated as memory location, and then you can extract data. So I'm going to match this with second. So the answer is going to be 4132. Oh, I'm sorry, 4312, which is option first. So this is going to be the correct answer, right? Okay, so this is the next question. In 8085 microprocessor, the digit 5 indicate that the microprocessor needs. Okay, so already we have seen that clock of the microprocessor is 3 megahertz. We're using a 3 megahertz clock and we're using a plus 5 volts supply. See, we're not using plus 5 and minus 5 both. Okay, we are only using plus 5 volt supply in 8085. So this digit 5 indicates that plus 5 volt supply only, right? We are only giving, in pins also we have seen that we are using two pins, VCC and ground. So we're giving a supply of plus 5 volt and a ground, which means a potential of 5 volt only. If we were to have been using minus 5 and plus 5 volt, the potential difference would have been 10 volts. We are not doing that. Okay, we're using plus 5 volt supply only. Fine, look at the next question. In 8085, which of the following performs load register pair immediate operation? So we've already seen the instruction set. What is LDAXRP going to do? This is going to load the accumulator with the data of the register pair. This is going to do the desired operation, LXIRP, comma data. What this is going to do is, it is going to load the register pair with the given data. Okay, fine. Look at the instructions also. What is this going to do? Load HL direct. Okay, this is load HL direct. This is going to load the HL pair directly with the address specified in the location. Okay, this is going to load. There is going to be a memory address here. When you reach this memory address, you're going to load the data at this memory address in the H and L pairs. Okay, suppose this address is 2000. So 2000 and 2001, whatever data is being stored at these memory locations, you're going to store them in HL pair. What does this instruction do? This is just going to increase the contents of a register pair by one. We've already seen the difference between INX and INR also, okay? INRB, INXB. We have seen the difference. What does this instruction do is, this is going to increase the contents of register B. Okay, suppose B was initially 01. So after execution of this instruction, B is going to be 02. What does this do? This increases the contents of BC pair. Okay, suppose B was 01 here, C was 02 here. So after execution of this instruction, B is going to be 01 only, C is going to be 03. Okay, so this is increasing the contents of register pair. This is increasing the contents of register. This is going to load HL directly with the data stored at the given address location. This is going to do the same thing with the accumulator. What this is going to do is, it's going to extract the memory location from this given register pair, whatever register pair is given. It is going to take the contents of that register pair as memory location, go to that memory location, extract data, and load the accumulator with that data. Okay, suppose you have given LDXB. So it is going to extract content from BC pair, whatever they are stored. This is going to be treated as a memory location, and at that memory location, whatever data is stored, we are going to store it in A. And this we know, this is load register pair immediate. So this here we are giving the data directly, which is going to be stored in the register pair. Fine. Now look at the next question now. Okay, so now we are having questions of UGC NET 2016. So we've given a program here now, and they're asking the contents of accumulator after the execution of following language program. Okay, we're going to look at it step by step. First step is MVIA 42H, which in decimal is going to be 66. I've just converted into decimal, okay? So contents of A are going to be 66. Contents of B are 5. Now what do we do is, we add B. Add B means contents of B are going to be added with contents of accumulator, and the result is going to be stored in the accumulator only. So contents of accumulator after execution of this instruction are going to be 66 plus 5. Now DCRB. DCRB means B decreases by 1, which means B has become 4 now. Jump not 0, UGC. See, the contents of B, contents of register B are not 0 yet, right? So we are going to jump to UGC. Again add B. Now just see, how many times is this loop going to run? Until and unless contents of B are 0, this loop is going to run, right? Which means that we are going to add 5 in the first loop. We are going to add 5. Next loop, you're going to add 4. 3, 2, 1. As soon as the value of B, suppose the value of B was 1 already. Now when you perform DCRB, B is going to become 0. This condition is false. Jump not 0 UGC. This condition becomes false. So you're going to exit. Till then, the value of A is going to be 66 plus 5 plus 4 plus 3 plus 2 plus 1, which is 81 in decimal. Okay, so here When you exit this loop, the value of A is going to be 81. Now what it is saying is add immediate 25H. 25H. This 25H is 37 in decimal. So what happens after this instruction is ADI 25 means add immediate data, right? This data 37 is going to be added with the contents of accumulator, which makes the result as 118 in decimal, or if I convert it in decimal, is going to be 76. So the contents of accumulator after the execution of this program is going to be 76. C option. This is the correct option. Right. Look at the next question. So this is a simple theory question. 8085 microprocessor has how many hardware interrupts? Okay, so we have looked at them separately also, but again we can take them. 8085 is having five hardware interrupts, which are RST 7.5, RST 6.5, RST 5.5, TRAP and INTR. Hardware interrupt means we are having separate pins for these interrupts. Okay, for these five interrupts, we are having separate pins. Okay, outside the microprocessor. If you just connect any of the pin with VCC, that is if you make any of them one, these are going to be okay, so we have learned the functioning of the interrupt. You can just see the lecture on interrupts for this. So basically 8085 has 5 hardware interrupts and also it is having 8 software interrupts. Okay, fine. Look at the next question. Which of the following in 8085 performs this given operation? See, there's a okay, we have learned about an operation DAD API. Okay, so what does this instruction do is, this is going to add the contents of this register pair with the HL pair. Suppose I'm giving a instruction like DAD B. So what is going to happen is, contents of BC register pair, contents of register pair BC are going to be added with the HL and stored in HL. So if I am supposed to perform this operation, then I'll have to give the instruction DADD. DADD, what happens is contents of DE are going to be added with contents of HL and the final result is going to be stored in HL pair. So the answer is going to be DADD, right? The register that stores all interrupt requests. Okay, so this is a interrupt request register. So from name also we can just see interrupt request register is the one which stores all interrupt requests. Okay, fine. Look at the next question. Dash addressing mode is similar to register indirect addressing mode, except that an offset is added to the contents of the register. Offset and register are specified in the instruction. Okay, fine. So so we know that this is the indexed addressing mode. What is happening in indexed addressing mode is you're giving an offset. Offset is, which is also known as the index. So what happens is when this offset is added to the base address, and both offset and register specified in the instruction. So this is the, you can just see about this in 8086 addressing modes. We have taken this topic completely there. So this is fine. This is similar to register indirect addressing, and except that offset is added to contents of the register. Okay, fine. Just look at this question now. Contents of accumulator after execution of this given language program. Okay, so we are just going to look at all the instructions step by step. So you can see MVI A 35. So A is going to be loaded with 35, which is just writing it in binary. Now we're moving MOV B comma A. What it does is, contents of A are going to be copied to contents of B. So B is going to hold 35. Set carry, what is does it? It makes carry flag as 1. Complement carry, what this does is it complements the status of carry flag. So initially carry flag was set, so now it's going to be reset. Carry flag is going to become 0. Now what does this instruction do is, this is going to rotate accumulator right with carry. RAR is with carry. Okay, so we have learned that there are two instructions, RAR and RRC. RRC is going to rotate the contents of accumulator right without carry, and this is going to rotate the contents of accumulator right with carry, which means that carry flag is also going to play a role here. So what happens to A is, see, we are rotating the contents of A to right, rotating contents of A to right with carry. With carry means that here MSB is going to be the carry. So what happens is this becomes and carry flag is going to hold 1 because this is going to be the contents of carry flag. This LSB going to go to the carry. Now what are we doing is XOR A with B. So we are just doing XOR operation with contents of A and B, right? So we're going to perform an XOR operation. So we've seen that this is a bitwise XOR. This instruction does a bitwise XOR. So this is going to be 1 1 1 1 0 1 0 0. So these are going to be the final contents of accumulator, which is 2F. So the correct answer is going to be 4. Option 4. After this operation, what happens is contents of A are going to be XORed with B and the final value is going to be saved in accumulator A. So this is going to be the correct option. Look at the next question now. 8085 microprocessor has dash bit ALU. So we know that all the register of 8085 are 8 bit long. So the ALU is going to be 8 bit long, okay? Because we are having data of 8 bits. So we are having a 8 bit ALU. This is going to be the correct option. The register that stores the bit required to mask the interrupt. Bits required to mask the interrupt. This interrupt mask register is storing the bits required to mask the interrupt. We have learned about masking the interrupts in detail in the lectures, so you can just refer that. Which of the following in 8085 performs HL is equal to HL plus HL? So we've already seen that there's an instruction as DAD RP which performs this operation. So suppose I need to add the contents of HL to HL, I'm going to give this command DADH. DADH, what happens in DADH is contents of HL are going to be added to contents of HL itself and the final result is going to be stored in HL pair. Fine. Look at the next question. In dash addressing mode, operands are stored in the memory. Address of the corresponding memory location is given in a register which is specified in the instruction. So in register indirect addressing, we have seen that what happens is we are giving a name of a register, contents of which are treated as memory location, and you go to that location, extract data, and then we are just getting the data. Okay, so operands are stored in the memory, right? And address of the corresponding is memory location is given in a register specified in the instruction. Okay, so we have seen instructions like MOV A comma M, right? So this M, this memory, this address is given by HL pair. Contents of HL pair are going to be treated as memory location. You go to that memory location, extract data, and then we are going to move them to accumulator. Fine. I think this is all for 2016. Now we're going to look at 2015 UGC NET questions. So this is asking what will be the output at port 1 if the following program is executed. So what we are doing is MVIB 82. So 82 is going to be loaded with, register B is going to be loaded with 82. A MOV A comma B, which means that contents of B are going to be copied to accumulator. MOV C comma A, which means that C is going to be loaded with contents of accumulator. D is going to be loaded with 37H. Output 1. Now see, what they are going to ask, what they are trying to ask you is that what does this instruction out do? What does this do? So we've already seen that in out instructions, both these instructions are going to operate on contents of accumulator, contents of accumulator, which means that whenever you're going to use these instructions in and out for any IO device, the contents are going to be accumulator contents. If you're giving out instruction, contents of accumulator are going to be output. If you are giving this in instruction, then whatever input is going to come, it's going to come in the accumulator. So only, it only depends on value of accumulator. Accumulator had the value 82. So when output at port 1 is going to be 8282 hexadecimal. Fine. Which of the following 8085 microprocessor has the lowest priority? So we've already seen the priority of interrupts. Highest priority interrupt is going to be trap. Then we have RST 7.5. Then we have RST 6.5. RST 5.5. And then lowest priority interrupt was INTR. So these are the five hardware interrupts, and we had seen their priority. We've also seen a circuit diagram where we saw why trap is, okay, so you can just look there, why interrupt is maskable, why one is not maskable. We had seen all these there. So you can just see, this is a non-vectored interrupt. All of the other are vectored interrupt. This is a non-maskable interrupt. We have seen this in detail while we've discussed interrupts. So you can just have a look. For now, lowest priority interrupts of all these is going to be INTR. This is a lowest priority interrupt. A CPU handles interrupt by executing interrupt service subroutine. By checking interrupts. Okay, so this is asking that when is the CPU going to check for interrupts. So when we saw interrupt, we saw that before execution of, after execution of each instruction in the last cycle, in the last clock cycle, the CPU is checking for interrupts whenever a CPU is executing a program. So before completion of each instruction or before the last cycle of each instruction, CPU is checking for interrupts. So the look at the first option, by checking interrupt register after execution of each instruction. Okay, so this is going to be the correct answer. After execution of each instruction, CPU is checking for interrupts, right? Okay. So we have discussed about this, right? That the pin INTR has to be high for at least this much microseconds, because the largest instruction in 8085 is call instruction. Call instruction having 18 T states. So we suppose that if microprocessor checks for interrupt before the last cycle, that is at 7.5 T. We've done this calculation though. So 17.5 into 1/3, we did this. Microsecond, this is how long INTR pin has to be high so that the CPU can notice it. You can just see this in lectures. But anyhow, CPU is checking for interrupts after execution of each instruction. Fine. Consider a 32-bit microprocessor with a 16-bit external data bus driven by 8 MHz input clock. Assume that this microprocessor has a bus cycle whose minimum duration equals 4 input clock cycles. And what is the maximum data transfer rate for this microprocessor? Okay, see, for this microprocessor, maximum bus cycle rate is going to be, so it is having a 8 MHz clock and minimum bus cycle is 4 input clock cycles. So maximum bus cycle rate can be 8 mega by 4, which is 2 mega per second, right? Because the clock was 8 megahertz and minimum duration of bus cycle was 4 input clock cycle. So this is the maximum possible bus cycle rate. Now the data transferred per cycle, since it is having a 16-bit data bus, so data transferred per cycle can be 16 bits, or I can say 2 bytes. Okay, so this is the data transferred per cycle. So now data transferred per second I can find by bus cycle into data transferred per cycle. So one bus cycle is 2 per second into 2 bytes. So this is going to be 4 megabytes per second. This is the data transferred per second, right? So option is going to be second, just 4 megabytes per second. So they had given us the clock frequency. They had given us the minimum cycles in one bus cycle. So we just find out the maximum bus cycle rate, then we found the data transferred per cycle, and so there, from there we can conclude data transfer per second. So it's going to be 4 megabytes per second, right? Let's look at the next question. RST7 instruction in 8085 microprocessor is equivalent to, okay, so we've already seen this table. 8085 is having eight software interrupts, RST0 to RST7, RST0 to RST7, which have their addresses like 00 0 8 10 18 20 28 30 and 38, and we have learned about these software interrupts that they are 1 byte call instructions. They are actually 1 byte call instructions, which means that whenever you are giving an interrupt, suppose RST2 you are giving, this internally executes call 0010. This is going to execute call 0010. Okay, so the address of RST7 is 0038. So RST7 instruction is going to be equivalent to call 0038. This is going to be the correct option. Call 0038. Fine. Look at the next question. What will the hexadecimal value in the register AX after executing the following instruction? So we are loading AL with the 15, which is 0F. AH with 15, which is 0F. Now we are performing, okay, so after execution of this, AX is having 0F. We have done a question of this model previously also, but okay. Now you perform XOR ALAL, which makes the contents of AL as 00. So AX is going to become 0F00. AX is basically AH, AL. Okay. This is 16-bit. This is 16-bit. So this is 32-bit. 32 bits, 16 bits, 16 bits. Fine. So this is going to be 00. So AX is 0F00. Now you loaded CL with 3. Now this is shift right. Shift right. AX, CL, which means that we have to shift the contents of AX right 3 times, because CL had contents 3. So we shift right this contents by 3 times. Okay, fine. So AX had 01E0. So the correct option is going to be third, C option. These are going to be the contents of AX after execution of this instruction, right? So this is all for UGC NET 2015. Now we're going to look at some questions of UGC NET 2014. This is the first question. So they're asking that which instruction is going to affect which flags, okay? So we're going to look at the instructions one by one and see which flags are affected. So just see exchange, what does this instruction do is, this is going to exchange the contents of HL and DE register pairs. Okay, HL and DE register pairs. Contents of these two register pairs are going to be exchanged. So flags are not involved in this instruction, because we are not performing any arithmetic operation. We are just exchanging, swapping the contents of these two pairs. So no flags are affected in execution of this instruction, right? Now look at the next sub, this is subtract operation. This is an arithmetic operation. So when this instruction is going to be executed, all the flags are going to be affected. All flags are affected in arithmetic operations, okay? This is set carry. What does this instruction do is, this is going to make the carry flag as 1. Okay, this the operation of this instruction is just to set the carry flag. Set the carry flag is, this has to make the carry flag 1. So only carry flag is affected. DCR is decreasing the contents of a register. Suppose you have given an instruction DCR B. B initially had 05. After execution of this instruction, B is going to have 04. So what happens is, all the flags are going to be affected in this operation, but carry flag is not going to be affected. Okay, carry flag is not affected. So this is going to be 3. So the answer is going to be 2, 4, 1, 3, which is option 4. So this is going to be the correct option, right? Look at the next question. How many times the following loop will be executed? How many times? Okay. LXI B0007, which this is going to see. What does this instruction do is, this is going to load immediate register pair with the data. So this is going to load the register pair BC with the given data. B is going to hold 00. C is going to hold 07. Okay, the higher bits of the data going to go in the B register, lower bits of the data are going to go in the C register. Fine. Now we are performing DCXB. What happens when you perform DCXB? It is going to decrease the contents of BC pair, okay? So B is again going to be 00, C becomes 06, MOV A, B, which means A is going to hold value 00. Or AC means or the contents of A with contents of C. Or operation we can say is like AND operation. If contents of A are 00, this is going to be like ADD operation. So A is going to hold the contents of C now. So this is going to hold 06. Jump not 0. LOP. Okay, so as many times the content of A is not going to be 0, this loop is going to be executed. So basically what happens is, A is just holding the content of C. So since contents of C is not 0, this condition is true and this loop will going to be performed again and again. So initially contents of C are 7, so this loop is going to be executed 7 times, 6 times for true condition, 6 times for true condition, and once for false condition. So this loop is going to be executed 7 times, okay? 7 times, fine. Look at the next question. Specify the contents of accumulator and status of SZ and CY flags when 8085 microprocessor following addition of 87H and 79H. So we're just adding two numbers, 87 and 79. Just perform the adding operation first. 11 is going to be 0 with a carry of 1. Second going to be 0, 1, 0, 1. 0, 1, 0, 1, 0, 1. So now what happens is, see, these are going to be the final contents of accumulator, which is 0, 0. So the contents of accumulator are going to be 0, 0. Sign flag is going to hold the MSB of the result, which is 0. 0 flag is going to be 1 since the final result is 0. So this is going to be 1. And carry flag is going to be 1 since a carry has occurred. So the answer is going to be option D. Carry flag is 1, 0 flag is 1, sign flag is 0, and accumulator is 0. Fine. I'll just look at this last question. So this is asking for switching from a CPU user mode to the supervisor mode following type of interrupt that is most appropriate. Okay, so see, software interrupt, what is does it? Type of instruction caused by special instruction set or by executing condition in microprocessor, we are giving this software interrupts. Okay, software interrupts, what are they going to do is, they are going to switch the CPU from CPU user mode to the supervisor mode. Using software interrupts we can do this. Okay, external interrupts are given in generally in case when there is a problem like power supply went off, something, some problem like this. Okay, you're giving external interrupts. So software use interrupts we are using for switching from CPU user mode to supervisor mode. Okay, fine. So this is all, these are all the questions that have been asked in UGC NET already. You can also practice other questions from some books, some practice books, and just watch lectures for explanations. If you find something that we have not covered in the lectures, you can just drop in comments, we can look at that.